السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين، وصلى الله تعالى وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، honorable elders and my dear respective brothers, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for once again blessing us with the opportunity to be sitting in his blessed house, the masjid, for the purpose of performing Salatul Jumu'ah. And we thank him subhanahu wa ta'ala by uttering the words Alhamdulillah. Now, I don't need to inform you, you can tell very well. Unfortunately, I'm not feeling very well, and I think the sound of my voice gives that away. Nevertheless, I have been requested to say a few words inshallah ta'ala. And as every other week, our honorable Imam shares with us a number of words of wisdom from which we can all benefit, and today was no different, alhamdulillah. There are a number of things which he taught us, and in the few minutes that I have, I would just like to pick on two things that he mentioned. And these two things are something that are relevant to every single believer, to every single Muslim. The first of them is about worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how our actions are either accepted or rejected by him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that the greatest form of worship is salah. So when we perform salah, we do it purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But being human beings, we will always have shortcomings. And our salah, you can never perform it in a manner which is truly worthy of being described as perfect or as befitting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's majesty. However, nevertheless, we try our best to perform salah and we try to improve all the time. But there is a certain type of worship which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only commanded, he introduced it as an act which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself performs. Now obviously in the case of Allah, we don't call it worship because Allah doesn't worship anyone, وَلِيَعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. But the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala performed this act, it makes it worship for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he commands many things in the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he orders us to pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he orders us to fast, to give charity, to perform a hajj. But never does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduce these actions as actions which are performed by him himself subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only exception is to send salat upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To send salat upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only is it a tradition, a sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the only act of worship which according to the ulama is guaranteed to be accepted. Because when we send salat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are invoking blessings upon him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meaning, we are not asking for anything for ourselves directly. When we say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, or Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, when we say this, we are invoking Allah to grant something to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's one thing which just crossed my mind and I think that needs to be clarified is, there is a difference between salat and salam. A lot of people, they think it's the same thing, it's not the same. Salat and salam is actually very different. Both of them are commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, sallu alayhi. Sallu is one command, send salat upon him. Wa sallimu tasliman, also give salam. We know what salam actually means. Salam means to make dua. When you say assalamu alaykum, for example, what you are doing is you're making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect this person, or grant him what he, grant him safety, or grant him peace, make him happy. So if somebody has worries, you give salam to them. You know, what you're doing is making dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes their worries. As for salat, it's slightly different. When I say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, what you're doing is you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send blessings upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And according to some mufassirun, the blessing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he glorifies Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the presence of his angels. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he speaks about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he glorifies him in the presence of the angels. And that is why when a person says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, when a person does salat ala nabi, the response comes from Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Man salla alayya wahidatan, sallallahu alayhi biha ashra. Whoever sends one salat upon me. So for example, if somebody says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad once, or sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once,
or whichever form of salat he says. If he says it once, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send 10 blessings upon him. And in other narrations it is mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only will he send 10 blessings upon him, he will also forgive him 10 sins and raise him in rank by 10. So when it comes to salat, it is a direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for salam, this goes directly to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Inna lillahi fil ardi malaika yuballighuna an ummati as-salam. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed certain angels all over the world. Their sole responsibility is to convey the salam of my ummah to me. So the salam goes straight to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When it comes to salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who responds. As I mentioned earlier, the hadith, if somebody gives salat upon Rasulullah once, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him 10 salawat, 10 blessings, and forgive 10 sins and so on and so forth. As for salam, it goes directly to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returns the salam himself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ مُسْلِمٍ يُسَلِّمُ عَلَيَّ إِلَّا رَدَّ اللَّهُ إِلَيَّ رُوحِي فَأَرُدَّ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no Muslim sends salam upon me, not salat by the way, gives me salam. So he says, assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi, for example, or whichever form he knows. And when he does this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring me the salam. Salam will reach Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he will return my soul to me and I respond to his salam. So if somebody sincerely gives salam to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responds to your salam, there could be no blessing greater than this. Because a salam is a form of dua. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he says wa alaykum as-salam, he is making dua for you. And if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes dua for you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely accept it. There's a very famous story narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he went to one of the houses of his companions radiallahu anhu, and he knocked on the door and he said, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. And the Sahabi, he did not respond. He heard Rasulullah, but he did not respond. And then again, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, hoping to grab his attention. The Sahabi, he could hear, but he didn't respond. A third time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. And then on the third time, he said, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. And he allowed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in. But he didn't do it the first time. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, why did you not respond the first time? He said, ya Rasulullah, I know that you repeat the salam up to 3 times. If somebody gives you salam, if somebody gives salam and they don't respond, you repeat it 3 times. And because I wanted you to do salam over and over again, so I didn't respond. Because if he said assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah once and he responded, that's only one dua by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he wanted Rasulullah to repeat this dua. So he did it 3 times so that he can receive the blessings of the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second thing which I wanted to mention, so anyway, before I go on to that, it is also a sunnah to do salat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Friday, during the day of Jumu'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says about the day of Jumu'ah, فَأَكْثِرُ فِيهِ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ عَلَيْهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that on the day of Jumu'ah, you should increase in giving me salat. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum asked, Ya Rasulullah, what about after you pass away? How can we give salat and salam upon you after you pass away? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ أَن تَأْكُلَ أَجْسَادَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. The Imam mentioned this. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it forbidden for the earth to eat, to decay the bodies of the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam. Therefore, we should increase in reciting durood upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Jumu'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, on the day of judgment, أَقْرَبُكُمْ إِلَيَّ مَجْلِسًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَكْثَرُكُمْ عَلَيَّ صَلَاتًا. The closest of you to me on the day of judgment will be those who send the most salat upon me. So we should try and increase in giving salat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before I conclude, the second thing which I want to mention is, because we just witnessed the day of Ashura yesterday, and I believe a lot of you are fasting today as well. One of the greatest lessons that we learn from Ashura, or more specifically from the incident of Karbala, is the fact that after we pass away, we either leave a legacy for which people will remember us, for which people will praise us and people will make dua for us, or we leave behind a tarnished reputation. So if you look at the incident of Karbala, we know that Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala an, he had a very small number of people with him. He had his family members with him and just his family members. And this is proof that he did not go to fight, as many people like to claim. His intention wasn't to cause havoc. His intention wasn't to fight. His intention wasn't to shed blood. Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala an, he went with his family and he went to Kufa because he thought that the people of Kufa will support him. When the army of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad, as commanded by Yazid, as masterminded by Yazid, when they killed the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they killed Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala an and his relatives. Till this day, any true Muslim, any true believer, they remember Imam Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu with love. And nobody with Iman and nobody with true faith and true love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam harbors love for Yazid. And that is why Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that no believer can have Iman and love for Yazid in the same heart. It's not possible. Although there are many people, especially from Bangladesh, I don't know where this came from, there are a lot of people who try to paint Yazid in a good picture, وَلِيَعَذُ بِاللَّهِ, and they're trying to portray Imam Hussein as the one who was on the wrong. This is a sign of Qiyamah, when the good people are being criticized and the bad people are being glorified. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to always keep us on the truth, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to resurrect us with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family. Wa akhiru da'wani alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.